Buenas, gracias y muchas tardes. Nosotras somos...
Ana,
Vale, Meme...
¡No, Puja!
Puja y Meme...
Meme...
Yemen y Pirimol. Y venimos a guiarlos a lo largo de la exposición virtual que van a ver esta tarde del Colegio Montessori, en el que se van a proyectar algunos proyectos, valga la redundancia, que se llevaron a cabo a lo largo de el año en las distintas materias. Anita, ¿nos querés leer un poco del cronograma de lo que vamos
sí,
a tener hoy?
Sí, voy a leerlo. Primero vamos a empezar con cuarto año, con las TED Talk, mezcladas ahí con unas de sexto, vamos a hacer una aparición mágica. Después
vamos a tener los experimentos en casa de tercer año, aproximadamente a las 19 horas, de la materia físico-química, en la cual no podemos prometer que no haya algún que otro incidente doméstico, pero tampoco es nuestra responsabilidad, así que no nos preocupa. ¿Qué sigue?
Bueno, después con cuarto año otra vez, con introducción a la física, vamos a ver un proyecto de energías renovables. Y para cerrar, todo en vivo, con cuarto año otra vez en biología, a cargo de Candela Ardiles, un proyecto de enzima catalasa.
O conocida por otras personas como enzima catalana, pero bueno, eso queda...
queda entre...
cada uno juzga cómo decide nombrarlo. Así que, bueno, los invitamos a ver las charlas de los clubes TED, que los chicos de cuarto estuvieron trabajando muchísimo para esto. Por favor, aquellos que estén mirando esto desde el Zoom del público, les pedimos que prendan las cámaras, que le pongan toda la onda y que estén ahí presentes. En la clase de inglés.
Y bueno, ¿y ya estamos?
You, this pair of skates may be only dye, an object, but for me, it is what changed my life completely, taking over inexplicable feelings. I'm sorry for saying this, but if you haven't found your passion, you still won't know what I'm talking about. But I promise that after this talk, you will go find that dream. Unless you already have that passion in your hands and you don't know what to do with it, you are in the right place. I know I'm talking too much. Let me start from the beginning. At 11 years old, I discovered how it felt to have an intense feeling about something. I realized I can't describe this word with only one word. It became a necessity, just like breathing. An unimaginable mix of feelings like happiness, also love, passion is called. Although sometimes that word is not enough, because sometimes it is something that you would give your life for. And although this is the only thing that I could never describe, today I try to put into words what this part made me feel every day, changing my life since I gave my first steps in roller skates. Days didn't have to pass for me to realize that it was something special, capable of giving me what nothing else could. I always knew that my love for skating will always live in me and die with me. I will never be alone. Maybe you know what I'm talking about. So let me tell you that if some crazy feeling came into your mind, you have just identified your passion. In a short sentence, is what you would describe as a unique and unforgettable happiness. That's the first step. It's crazy, right? Before finding my essence, I didn't know anything about this sport. And now, I can't describe myself without the word skating inside. So I can say I'm the proof that your passion must not be in your life to be a passion. You will find it, because that's the destiny we all have in common. But I would like to explain how it feels to have a passion, because I think by explaining it, it would be more understandable why something is so unforgettable, so difficult to undone, and generate so powerful dreams. First of all, a passion is not something that you look for. You don't decide what you are passionate about. If I could choose, I would never choose this board. Seriously, it's very dangerous. But I think life put skating in my life for me to be braver, because I'm full of fears. Secondly, not everything is rosy. And by that I mean, not everything is happiness or love, but also anger. By loving something so much, you can feel anger, the most unbearable anger that can exist if something goes wrong. Also, sadness. You can feel a lot of sadness if something sad happens, no matter how minimal it is related to your passion. And as passions do, they raise feelings to their highest level. Every feeling will appear, but the good ones make you stay no matter what, because you won't feel something like that for something else other than your passion. To feel in paradise, an endless peace, a misunderstood happiness, an infinite love for a finite moment. That's what I call unforgettable. As a gift, dreams are born inside us, hand in hand with our passions. They don't ask you if you want them, they just appear and make you love them. Yes, it sounds a little selfish, but they represent in a perfect way the hope and the desire humans can feel. As passions, they won't go anywhere. You can ignore them, but they will always be there until you try your best to get them. Just as parents do when they teach us how to walk, they will wait for you all the time in the world if it's necessary for you to catch them and finally being able to walk. So, why do we give up? If it's hope, why do you automatically think this is not going to work without trying anything? If you had asked me a year ago, maybe I would have told you that I didn't know. Maybe I would have said that it is because we all are human and blame all my disappointments in life for not wanting to feel another disappointment again. But this question is here for me today. And my answer is totally different. But let me ask you a question first. Did you manage to fulfill your dream? Did you try? If your answer is yes, I invite you to leave the room, please. Just kidding. Congratulations. If you tried, you're a very brave person. Please do not stop trying. If you didn't try to fulfill your dream yet, I must tell you that I went through the same thing just a year ago. So if I'm here now, it is because that answer has changed. I may understand you more than you think. The word fail used to scare me. For years, I thought that my dream was impossible to achieve, so I decided to give up and forget about that stupid dream. But I couldn't. And now I'm here giving an inspirational talk, sharing how I have taken my final decision of not giving up. Let's go back to the question. Why do we give up? First of all, I have to tell you what I had to went through, because on the road is when many of us lose hope. I had two voices in my mind. Let's say my dream of reaching the World Skate Competition was the Good Angel. And my fear of failure was the devil. That voice is very difficult to shut up. It can stop questioning, what if? What if I don't get it? What happens if I try hard, but in the end it doesn't work? What if all my effort is in vain? What if I disappoint my family, my friends, or my coaches? All their support was in vain too. What if I never make it? If I spend all my time in life to an impossible dream? So stupid. What if I'm not strong enough? As time went by, I began to realize what is the difference between those who have fulfilled their dreams and those who had not. Those who had tried knew how to put aside the what if and start thinking, how do I do it? All the people who achieved their dreams in life went through all these questions. The difference is how this question affects them. How they decide to take these unknowns as a challenge, as a defiance, as something insignificant or possibilities that are scary. I have an example. Tonya Harding, she was the best skater in the world because she did not give up. His father abandoned her, she was poor, and she had not the best teacher in the world, but she did it because she had passion. Another different example is my coach. She told me she used to dream about being in an enormous competition of skating, but she gave up because of her conditions. She had to work, she didn't have time or money. What I want to say with this is that it is not easy to forget about the what if, but it is unfair to blame our conditions. It is unfair to blame our money, our work, our family, or our coaches. Because if you think better, our passion and dreams are permanent. Our conditions aren't. So if your conditions do not allow you to advance, change your conditions. If you think that your dream is so impossible to achieve, look for that possibility and take the risk. Today, I'm trying to fulfill my dream. I managed to silence that voice. And today, I believe I can help others to silence it, only with words that can make you see life differently as I see it today. Because after all what I went through, I created a new way of thinking that doesn't allow me to give up. Number one is called win or win. This makes us forget that fear of wasting our time, of wasting effort, of wasting moments. That's a wrong concept. By trying, we only have the option of winning things. We don't lose time or moments. We gain experience. And that time you think you lose is used for being happy, keeping moments in our hearts that will remind us in the future how well we use our time when we finally realize that being happy is not a simple task. Love and happiness we get from trying, and it is worth more than a simple gold medal. It is not a secret that the only moments remembered in life are the happy ones. You will enjoy all the process in which you try to fulfill your dream. Number two. Why does the word failure should not scare me? Believing in destiny helped me overcome this possible failure. How? Well, it took me a while to realize that not everything depends on me. Then I created this thought. If I don't achieve my dream after having tried them, it is because it was not my destiny and I'm in this world for something else. It is not because I'm not enough, or I did not try hard enough. I did not achieve that dream because in life, everything happens for a reason. Number three, life is one. This helped me decide that I'm going to try. How? Let's say it rushed me in a certain way. It might be a cliche, but it makes me think a lot about life. We take for granted that we will have many years to live when we really don't know that. Here is when I start thinking about my last day on Earth. Knowing myself, I would regret not having tried and never forget if I would have achieved it. I want to die knowing that I have tried. And that I have won much more than I dream of, because I know I would be proud of myself. And the last one, number four, what is life about? I came to the conclusion not only why I shouldn't give up, but also what is life about? Opening the doors to the best decisions that I can make. The following words tell me everything I need to hear. Of all the path to choosing life, there is only one that will be worth it. not the one that will give you power, not the one that will bring you money, but the one that will give you happiness. That's why we must pursue the path of dreams. Thank you very much for your time.
All the process in which you try to fulfill your dream. Number two, why does the word failure
Between 6 months in quarantine start here in Argentina. At that moment, don't tell me you weren't happy about staying at home. I mean, I was happy. I had 2 weeks ahead without classes. Or that's what we thought. How many of us lost activities or events because of the coronavirus? I did. I was supposed to go to many concerts and birthday parties. But that's nothing compared to what happened to my friend. She has always dreamed of her 15th birthday party. She got everything ready, like her dress, the guests, even the food. A fun fact is that she had to eat all the chocolates on her own because they were going to expire. I hope I'm not the only one who always thinks about when this is going to end and when we'll be able to return to our daily activities or even our routine. I miss hanging out with my friends. I mean, all we miss hanging out with our friends. But what I miss the most is spending time with our grandparents who live far from home. Also, I miss little things such as giving a hug. I mean, before the coronavirus, we used to kiss when we greet someone. But what about now? How long will it take us to get to those habits? I suppose that for a while, that will be fair, and we are going to ask ourselves, shall I kiss him, or does he prefer to shake hands? I also miss hanging out with my friends, like going to the cinema or just for an ice cream. I spoke with a doctor who works at the Santo Gianni Hospital in downtown Buenos Aires, where the cases are increasing every day. He told me that he cannot tell me the exact day when this is going to end, but he believes that it will be not that long, because people no longer tolerate being locked up and need to leave for work. He doesn't think that it will cost too much to return to our old habits, but for a long time we're going to continue keeping our distance, cleaning our house and our hands, and wearing masks. He also said that those who are more affected are the old people who are at risk of complication, health personnel due, and low-income people because of the economic issues. I also asked him about the vaccine that is so talked about, and he said that he does not believe that it will be available in the short term. The production of a reliable vaccine requires many steps and studies to support your application, and I don't think we are close to achieve it. I know we are all tired of the confinement, but it's necessary. We have to take care of ourselves because we defend together. Wash your hand at home unless you have to do some essential activity, and obviously, let's be responsible. Thank you.
When I was little, all my friends in school had straight hair. There was maybe one other girl that had curly hair like me, but that was it. The fact that my hair was curly made me stand out between all my classmates. Every time I look around, I saw my friends with a sleek and tidy look. So I wanted to be like the other girls and have straight hair too. Every morning before going to school, I would make a tall ponytail and brush my roots with water so they would look straight. Years later, I understood that society always showed me girls with straight hair, in advertisements, TV posters, and social media. When I was little, I received a lot of compliments about my hair. Love your hair, it looks so pretty, wish I had those curls. And I always responded that I'd rather have it straight. But eventually, I accepted it and understood that my hair was unique. like everyone's hair is unique and that it defines me as a person. This is my natural hair. As you can see, it's very long, but when I was little, my curls were more defined. Thinking about my story with hair made me realize that's the way the world works, and things like this still happen nowadays. People that have curly hair want straight hair. People with straight hair want curls. People that are tall want to be short, and people that are short want to be tall. As we all know, the beauty industry is present all the time. Personally, I'm very into it, and I like to dress up, do my makeup and hair for a special occasion or simply for fun. I have curls, and sometimes I straighten them. I straighten all my hair for a special occasion or simply because I'm bored. When people go through a rough time or are very happy, they may choose to change their hair to feel better with themselves. A lot of people like to now and then straight or curl their hair, maybe for a special occasion or simply for fun as I do. This is to create change. For example, if someone has straight hair and decides to curl it, it is because they would like to see themselves in another way, to feel pretty, and there's nothing wrong with that. Still, I find a negative side to it. Every time I straighten my hair, I spend over an hour on it, and sometimes I'm late because of it. It takes way too much time, and I'm sure I'm not the only one that has the same problem. This happens because there hasn't been a big advance or impact in the equipment and products that we use for hair. For example, the curling iron was first patented in the 19th century, and the practice of hairstyling has been dated back to 2000 years before Christ. Hair straightening has been around since the 1880s, since the time of ancient Egypt. In 1896, Shuko Shamatista invented permanent straightening. We still use these equipment and techniques these days, and even though there are products and equipment that do this faster, they are not quicker enough. There are many, many products and equipment out there, but things could be better. They could be easier than we thought. So, what would happen if it existed a product that made it easier to get ready? What would happen if we had a more practical and less time-consuming product? What would happen if we didn't have to apply heat to have straight or curly hair? Well, I have imagined a product that will help with these problems. I believe this product will have a big impact in the beauty and health environment and will help a lot of people to get ready easier in the day-to-day. This product will consist of the following things. It will come in two formats, to straight or to curl your hair. You apply it in the shower, and when you come out, you don't have to dry it. The cool thing will be that the air will dry it into a straight or curly way. And once it's on, you won't have to worry about it when you leave the house. The effect will last for 24 hours. The chemical composition of this product will be safe for the people and the environment. It will be a product specially designed for those special occasions when you would like a change. Obviously, things in excess aren't good, but once in a while, it is amazing to do your hair and have another look from the everyday. Anyone will be able to use this product with any restrictions. Hair defines us. It's a part of our personality and tells a lot about who we are. I may not have understood this back then, when I was little, but I do now. It is very important to accept your natural hair, but not listening to society or what people might think, leaving stereotypes aside and becoming your own person. Beyond a product that straightens or curls your hair, there are a lot of possibilities to play with it, to have fun, to feel pretty, and to change your mood. Love your hair, but once in a while, if you like it, change it. Hopefully, one day, a product like this might come out, helping me and others to get ready much faster. Now, what I want you to do is to play with your hair. Cut it, dye it, style it in a different way, or just appreciate it the way it is. And next time you go out or have a special occasion, remember about this product and how lucky we will all be to have it around. Thank you.
Why do we take time for granted? Why don't I do it now? These thoughts can be really life-changing. These are questions that almost every one of us in the front of our lives ask to ourselves, and mostly now in quarantine. Also, when we want to say or do something and we don't do it, and say I'll do it later or after, not now. But how do we know or how can we guarantee that after or later exists? Life is too short and we don't know when it's going to finish. Death comes without asking and we must live our lives to the fullest without doubting about things. This idea came to my mind. Well, I've been through many situations in which I had to make decisions as many of us had. For example, simple decisions such as what to wear, or very difficult ones as having to decide which of your parents to live with when they are divorced. Sometimes I have felt sad or angry because I didn't choose what was good for me, because of what others will say or think, or because about how would they feel. One day, I was listening to the song The Night from Avicii, and the thought of living more my life came to my mind. The lyrics were what made me think the most. The video also shows videos of him just living his life to the fullest. Now he's dead, and that makes me really sad. But at least I know he really enjoyed his life and what he did. It makes you change your point of view about life, at least it has changed mine. These lyrics changed my life completely, and although I still doubt before doing things, I have his words in my mind all the time. But doubting about decisions in life is a common thing for everyone. More than one of us regretted not doing some things, for example, talking to someone, doing a certain sport, or a simple thing, such as not saying the answer of something in class because of fear of what the others will say, or with the thought that what we're going to say was wrong. After these situations, we regretted not having acted before, and we maybe think of what would have happened if we had done this. This have gotten even worse now in quarantine, because, for example, a week before quarantine we said, okay, I'll do it next week, and next week never came. Now we think of what we've done. Why didn't I do it before when I could? And we have a crisis. How many of us passed through this? How many regrets do you have now? See, it's better to regret what we have done than to stay with the doubt. My way of thinking changed when I was young, 10 years old maybe. But I started living my life more intensively and doing things without thinking too much in 2019 due to some problems. This could be really relevant to more than one of us, because it can help you to live happier and to be freer, not to be afraid. Obviously, there's always a limit. We can do things impulsively. What does this mean? That we have to have a balance between what makes us happy and what makes people sad. For example, if you want to hurt someone because you just want to, you can, because this is affecting others in a bad way. But for example, if you want to come out as gay, lesbian, transgender, etc., you have to think about you and only you. Because if this makes people sad or angry, it's their problem, not yours. You're not hurting anybody. So I'm saying this again. This is really life-changing and helps you to be happier and freer. And remember, if you really want to do something, just do it. You'll never know what can happen next. Thank you.
Through the years, as a small group of high school students, we started the project without knowing the impact it was going to have on our surroundings. What began as a game of debate and consensus personifying the great politicians of the world became a tool for expression and growth, something that seemed as far away as being able to fight for our beliefs and make our voice be heard. We saw it reflected in those young children who follow our steps by grabbing a microphone, dressing in a suit too large for their size, and defending their position to arrive at a midpoint where the world is fair to everyone.
So, what does it mean to make a change? Or in other words, what does it mean to be a leader of change? As students who are one step away from adulthood, today we look back in time and search for all the tools that the school gave us in all these years to be able to move forward.
Being a leader implies commitment.
Being a leader involves listening and communicating.
Being a leader involves generating small actions for a great cause. Every day we have the opportunity to choose who we want to be and the impact we want to make on the world. We can move masses, or we can move one heart at a time. Because the key to change is not precisely its massiveness, but its strength and our conviction.
Change in reality is something that happens with the accumulation of all the small and big actions that we generate on a daily basis.
Yes, it is our problem. It is no longer about politicians or old people in suits. It is our reality, and it is up to us to decide what we want to do with it as well.
So, when we get out of school and become adults, we know that we have all the tools to change our little world, starting with those around us. Let's communicate, let's talk, let's make what affects us visible, let's seek conscious, let's be human, let's be the agents of change we want to see in the world. All our actions have a weight on us and society. Every day, we have the opportunity to make this world a better place. Are you ready to take the responsibility of being a future leader?
Did you ever think of doctors in this very situation? We all know what is happening with the virus, which is all over the world. This pandemic affects the doctors who spend many hours of their day in hospital risking their life or for others. If we want to help the doctors, and of course the family of each of them, we must take care of ourselves, either with masks or washing our hands, respecting the distance between people, so that infected people stop earning hospitals. And these doctors do not risk their lives, nor that of families. This issue is super important, and you have to act with caution. Why? From my personal experience, I have visited a hospital where there were many infected patients, obviously with all the protections and personnel. It made me sad to see people feeling so bad, many in intensive care. Relatives were desperate to be allowed to see them. Others took in the test to see if they had the virus, and behind all that. Were the doctors doing their best to return safely to their family? But one of the things that also worries me the most is my uncle Eduardo, a doctor at the hospital I visit, who himself told me that the situation is out of control. This is world issues, is very dangerous, that more people come every day infected, and that he continues to go to help as much as he can, always risking his life and that of his family to help. That is what a doctor does. And it made me sad to see him a little separate from his family in order not infecting them, or every day going to a place where he do not know if that day the virus will catch him. But he does it for the people, and so that is his end son. People are desperate for what is happening, and very few think about of doctors and experience it. Doctors run serious risk working in hospitals every day, despite the situation of each hospital, whether private or public. We know that it is not easy to control the virus that originated in China and spread over the world. So you can have to be concerned and support the heroes who are at the front fighting the virus, helping thousands of people to recover. Considering what is happening now, public hospitals have many disadvantages since they do not have enough materials. For example, in a public hospital in Buenos Aires, many doctors were infected because they didn't have masks to cover their mouth with. Private hospitals have more advanced since they have more materials and are in a better economic situation. But we have to in mind that one of both sides, this virus is affecting life size. Science, they lose space in hospitals, and both of doctors or parents are under risk of becoming infected. We must all begin to take care of ourselves more. Science, there are people who do not take care of themselves as they should. They go without a mask. They do not respect the distance between people, not only for ourselves, for our loved ones. And for the doctors who are fighting every day to make this madness pandemic end. When making direct contact with another person, we run the risk of getting sick. If your infection gets serious and you have to be assisted at the hospital, a doctor must treat you. Then he runs more risk than he was already running, and we are also putting doctors' family at risk. So we must take care of ourselves, not only ourselves, but for everyone. I'm saying this, and I'm not making it up. I'm saying it because I have my uncle in the hospital who tells me about day to day, and he tells me, then you get sick. You not only affect yourself, but also all the people around you. Seeing what is happening makes me feel sadness and helpless in not being able to do anything. So I ask myself, is there something we can do to help? The answer is yes. I want to make people aware that if we all take care of ourselves and continue with the necessary precautions for the good of all of us. And for the doctors who are the ones who are risking every day, this will end. There are many people who do not take care of himself because they believe that it cannot happen to them. But the reality is that it can happen to anyone. And if you don't do anything for yourself, do it for others. Thank you.
At the beginning of the quarantine, I decided to become a vegetarian. This is something that I had planned a lot of months in advance, but I didn't do it before because I was out of time. Why do you think I would stop eating meat? It's a matter of taste. I have chosen this diet because I want to keep animals safe, and I believe they have the same rights that we have. Let me tell you about my short experience as a vegetarian. Food is something very important in our life. All of us have to eat because that is a fact. But there are two types of people. The ones that think carefully about their diets and those that don't matter what they are consuming. Most of us think about what we are putting inside our body. Different types of diets exist. Most of the people in the world have a diet that includes meat apart from vegetables and fruits. But another part is vegetarian. That means they do not consume meat. Changing your diet can change your life in many aspects. It's obviously something that is not too easy to carry out, but is it possible? It is important in this part to highlight that you have to be hopeful, patient, and enjoy the moment. I've experienced this wonderful and weird feeling that you have at the time you change your diet, one that includes meat and animals, to one that is friendly with them and with the environment. The two first months were okay, but then I started to give in to temptation, and I feel frustrated. Of course, I knew then that I had to consult a nutritionist to help me reduce the consumption of meat. The step of visiting a nutritionist is the first one after wanting to. It is also important to be more accompanied by a professional to help you be responsible with your body. You have to clear all the doubts away and be curious and interested in the topic to learn more about this. The nutritionist gives you reliable information and dispels the myth that you perhaps encounter on internet websites, gives you a planned diet and a lot of tips. During my process, I have been through a lot of different feelings that went from motivation to a sense of failure. This is something that can happen. But it's important that you still believe in yourself. Now, I feel that I have more resistance when I practice sports. I have also started to drink 2 liters of water per day. As a result, I think my skin is getting better. Nowadays, I can say that I have a balanced diet and a balanced life. I visit my nutritionist, and I am already a vegetarian. I hope that my experience can be an example to show you that you can, perhaps not at the first time, but you have to try again as many times as necessary to reach the goal that you are looking for. From failed experiences, you have to learn a lesson, but you don't have to stop there. You have to wake up and try again. Be hopeful and allow you to have more and more experiences. Now, if you hadn't asked yourself to change your diet and life before, what are you doing now? And if you have tried and failed many times, try again.
Have you ever thought of something and it ended happening? Something you wanted so bad for a long time and it finally came true? That isn't a coincidence. That's the law of attraction. Thoughts become things. We become what we think. We attract what we think. See yourself living in abundance and you will attract it. If you can think of yourself buying a new car, getting into business, finding your soulmate, if you can imagine how that looks like, you're emitting a frequency of energy to the universe. Your thoughts are sending a magnetic signal that eventually draws the parallel back to you. Imagine the universe is like the genie in the bottle. Your wish is my command. If you can see it here, you're gonna have it here. Into all of our concepts, but I never really paid attention to what she said. But one day, my friends and I started joking about it. Law of attraction should be the phrase we use the most. It can be a way to stay positive, we thought. But after a while, I noticed it worked for real, and it was a real thing. So I started being more interested in this and started seeing it in a more serious way. I set myself to investigate, watch documentaries and read online, and I noticed how much this affects my and everyone's lives. So I thought of this as a way of telling people the importance of the law of attraction. Most people don't realize something happens to them because of the law of attraction, because most of the times it isn't even intentional. It just happens. For example, some time ago, I was planning on going somewhere with my friends on the next Saturday, and we needed it to be a sunny day. But everywhere and everyone was saying it was going to rain. So we said, what do? Should we cancel? But we didn't. We decided we were going to wait until the last second to see if it rained or not. We kept on planning everything, thinking what we were going to do there and having fun just thinking about it. So when the day finally came, it was a beautiful sunny day, we had a great time, and it started raining while we were back home. Thinking of the rain and going to have to come, we would have missed the incredible day we had. But this goes every way. For example, think of a person who suffers from claustrophobia, afraid of going into an elevator because of the fear of getting stuck in there. They are thinking of what would happen if the elevator stopped. They are thinking of the elevator stopping. So when the person eventually gets in the elevator, every thought they have had will become real, and the elevator will stop. The law of attraction doesn't care whether you picture something to be good or bad, or if you wanted it or not. It is responding to your thoughts. A person in a relationship is thinking, I don't want to fight, I don't want to fight, I don't want to fight. That's what they will be getting, fights. Because they are thinking of it, so they are attracting it. The law of attraction is all about the feelings, and passion is one of the most important ones. You can be passionate in a positive or negative way. So you need to focus on the good feelings, the happiness, the joy, the laughs you have. They are the best way to attract positive things to your life. You can be sad. It's okay not to always be okay. But don't let that tear you down and make you think you're not going to get really what you want. Times or heard that people ask, do you believe in the law of attraction? So let me tell you, it is not something to believe or not. It is not some kind of conspiracy. It's a fact. But if you don't believe it, it's not going to work for you because you're thinking it isn't a thing. You're thinking it's not going to happen. So it's not, because that's how it works. Even though it is something that happens naturally, there are ways for us to intentionally make it work. There are many, many ways to do it. The most important one is, as I said before, first, define and focus on what you do want and not on what you don't want. Be conscious of the quality of your thoughts and feelings. Feel, visualize, and act as you already have what you're wishing for. Take action. In order to open a clear path for the law of attraction, it's highly important to show coherence with what you want. If you would like to have a cat, but on the street you kick them in the head, you are not acting in coherence with what you want. In a way, coherence of our actions is like removing all the obstacles in the way towards your goals. Many people also recommend saying affirmations like, I have a beautiful house, or I am healthy, or write it down on a piece of paper a certain amount of times. It is said to help your brain break all the mechanisms of thoughts and create new ones. Finally, what you definitely need to avoid is impatience or disbelief. If you say, this doesn't work, or what is going on that I don't get what I want, you're sending the wrong message, because the universe does not have a sense of humor and does not understand irony. What you say is a command. So how does the universe send you what you want? Unfortunately, the universe cannot deliver a package to your front door or through. It is not magic, it's a scientific law. You need to be paying attention to the doors of opportunity that will present to you, through a friend, through a neighbor, or through a stranger. Don't tell the universe how it should send it to you or by what means. The way that the universe will respond is through synchronicity. According to Francois Martin, PhD of the Laboratory of Theoretical Physics at the University of Paris, quantum physics defines synchronicity as the significant coincidences which appear between a mental state and an event occurring in the external world. For instance, you're thinking about a song you haven't heard in years. And as you have the thought, the song starts playing on the radio. This coincidence occurs between your mental state and your physical state. So it seems your mind is connected to the world around you. This also could happen between two individuals. For example, you think of a friend you haven't seen in a while, and the next day you accidentally meet on the street. This synchronicity is called quantum entanglement. That is a connection between mind and matters and the minds of multiple people. It is a scientific fact that everything in the universe is energy. A table is energy in a very dense state. Our thoughts are energy in a subtle state. But all energies irradiate vibration and has a specific frequency. When we think positively, we emit a certain kind of vibration. And we are like an antenna that attracts the same sort of vibrations. The law of attraction refers to the attraction of energies. And whether it is positive or negative, same vibrations will attract each other. This is why it's best when we are consciously aware of what our thoughts are. Before, I mentioned how some people don't believe in the law of attraction. So there is the explanation of why I can assure you it is not a conspiracy and it is not something to believe or not. It's fact. What I think is the most remarkable point of applying the law of attraction, it's not the material stuff. It's that to achieve that stuff, you need to be positive to every aspect in life. It makes you look at the bright side. Try and find something good out of the bad, because if you're always negative and looking for the bad stuff, always criticizing and complaining about everything, you will get in more and more discomfort. Why do you think when we are in a bad mood, everything wrong? We hook our clothes to the handle, we walk into the puddle. That's because we are emitting bad frequencies. We wake up and say it's going to be a terrible day, so we go into the day thinking and attracting unpleasant matters. The best you can do is try and be positive on every circumstance in life, even though it isn't easy. You can use the law of attraction just as an excuse and attract positive things to your lives. Now, I invite you to think of a moment in your life where you thought of something so much it finally happened, whether you wanted it or not, and I assure you, you will find at least one. And I also invite you to have this in mind from now on and see how everything changes. And remember, keep thinking of the sun and the rain will go away.
When you finish high school, you're expected to have chosen a course of studies related to what you like. So, we have been asking ourselves, how did we choose what we want to study at the university? How can we be sure this is going to be the right thing to do? What did we do that made us interested in studying this?
In order to know what to study at the university, you need to know what your interests are. Doing something that you don't like will not make you happy. This decision is important because you will work for it. Yes, you can leave the course of study you are studying, but you are wasting a lot of time.
To find what you like, you must know yourself. Pay attention to the minor details and concern yourself with the things you like. When it comes to choosing a course of studies, there are teenagers who like to go to university after they have finished secondary school, as there are teenagers who prefer to experience the gap year.
We went through these steps, and what happened was that when we participated in this club of what call it a bit of our interest, we found it more interesting than we thought it would make us discover more things related to that club or action.
And that made our experience more fascinating. Our parents looked at us happily for the decision we made, as they know that we like what we want to study. It is not bad to find what you want to do years before graduating. It is not bad to take a gap year to discover, as long as you find out what you like and makes you happy.
So, we recommend to keep looking for your curiosity. If you haven't found them yet, you might want to participate in every class of your enjoyment. You have until the end of the last year of high school to find some of your interest, and if you haven't not decided yet, you can take a gap year. Have you done any of these recommendations? Do you participate in a club of your interest? Have you ever thought of what life after high school will be like?
Let me tell you a story. The first humans being in history ran for their own sustenance in search for food. Our ancestors chased their prey for hundreds of kilometers until they hunted it. Today, in a world hiding place of our brains, wander that mental spirit that we need so much to run an ultra marathon. For those who are not aware of what this sport is about, let me tell you about it. It consists of running long distances greater than 42 kilometers on roads and trails where our ancestors chased their prey. Today, there are races running from 50 kilometers to 300 kilometers, distances that manage to beat both those who are starting the activity as well as those who practice it every day. And it is here that our ancestral mentality should come into play. My little experience allows me to get into this game and be able to tell you what it is like to feel physically devastated, but waiting to reach the goal that I have been waiting for so many months. Because behind all this, there is daily physically as well as mental training. I started running a couple of years ago when my current trainer told me to trust him because the love of this sport was unique. And it was only enough to trust him to confirm what he promised. Because of my age, 22 kilometers was what my trainer allowed me to run. I was delighted to put everything I had in me to the test and show myself who I was and how far I could go. 7:30 a.m. I am ready at the starting line along with 2,200 other participants and a lot of other people who are going to be witnessing that beautiful race. After the first kilometers, my body barely recognized what is to come, when my fresh mind waits step by step from the moment when it must act fully. After a 6 kilometers full climbing up a slope, my legs are already burning and my body is already asking for a rest. And this is where the fun begins. A fight between my mind and my legs. My mind knows that it loses, the feeling of disappointment after the dropout will be very bad. So the mind comes into play and takes center stage in the race. And this is just the beginning. After 50 kilometers, I begin to realize the true climax of an ultramarathon, the point where my head wants to continue and reach the finish line, and my body to sit and rest for days. It is here that I fall in love with the ultra, where I realize the passion that this sport generates and however entered cannot leave it. At kilometer 22 and a few steps from the finish line, my legs are reborn as if I just started. And with one last effort, I finished. A thousand of things crossed my mind at that moment. But what impresses me the most is being able to realize how important the support of the mind is for a long distance race. With only 22 kilometers, I got an idea of how difficult it could be to do 100, 200 kilometers and how much I would like to face such a challenge. It really made me think if it is possible that we could all be prepared for it. Can any human being achieve the feat of mentally fighting his body to finish a 100 kilometers race? Tim Noakes of the University of Cape Town, South Africa, suggests that it is our brains and not muscles that dictate how far we can go. Learning intensive activities our brain unconsciously lays the foundation to prevent the body from succumbing to extreme exertion. Scientists from around the world specialize in the mental area of athleticism, where they are elite or amateur level, little by little are confirming theories that it is not only necessary to be physically well prepared for a long distance race, but also how well prepared the athlete is mentally. This does not happen only in the ultramarathon. Perhaps you will ask yourself, what do I have to do if I never in my life I have run nor planned to run 100 kilometers up a mountain? How can knowing about this help me if I never planned to run. First of all, I'm going to tell you, run. Run, because when you run, you connect 100% with your body. You have all five senses activated, seeing what is happening inside you, listening to yourself. And on the other hand, let me tell you that the same scientist who believe and confirm that mindset while running is of great importance in the ultra marathon also confirm that this mindset isn't carried out into everyday life intuitively and without intention to do it so. The human mind prepares itself to make life as possible, but there are times when the mind puts you in the test, and that is when you can see who is mentally prepared and who is not. This does not mean that every day at all time we are using an ultra-marathoner mentality, but it is true that it sometimes uses it. And for this reason, it is that scientists recommend daily mental training to be prepared for these extreme situations that can happen to us. Studies have confirmed that those people who have a good mentally preparation achieve 120% greater improvement in each of their workouts, while those who do not adequate mental health do not exceed 14% in their performance. For this reason, it is that those who run long distances create a greater memory, do handle of things intuitively without having to think about them, and in turn to improve the range of vision when having to retain an image. Now, these are the advantages that you get when you are mentally prepared. But what happens if you are not mentally prepared before a long distance race? From my own experience, I cannot say much about it because I always like being both physically and mentally prepared for a long for a race, because I take into account how important both of these are. But what happens to those who face something without even knowing that they are going to encounter and are not mentally trying to face difficulties? This already gives clues that bad things can happen. There are countless of examples of people who knew they were not prepared for that type of race, and you decide to start from the starting point with the rest of the competitors and did not turn well. A clear result of this are the dropouts in race, when the body dominates and not the mind. The dropouts are mostly justified by tiredness, but I will not call it that. I will call it defeat, as I comment at the beginning of the talk. The defeat of the mind against a difficult rival, such as physical conditions, does not have good consequences. This defeat leads the body to have total control, and it may lead to injuries, dehydration, loss of minerals, where the mind does not decide what it to incorporate into the body. And this is how it works. The gap between the mind and the physical state is not very wide, but those who fall into it really manage to keep going. You must always be careful not to fall when you walk on the edge. You must seek that domain in order to continue step by step the way to the goal. There are cases of large ultra runner who were injured in the race or even abandoned it, and in most of the cases, They admit that they have good consequences, that they have given up due to lack of mental preparation, and not only from the difficulty of the race. This speaks well for what I have mentioned throughout the entry talk. The race mindset is super important and should never be put aside. So, does a good career mentally help both to finish this race and to do different things in everyday life? After everything traveled and commented on the matter of preparation, I say to you, do not stop training your mental health. It will help you in everything that surrounds you, and above all things, you will be able to face and make decisions in a unique way. It is important not to give up on anything that you set out to do in life. And this is what mental preparation is for, to know what to do in difficult situations. Because abandoning is simple as saying, I'm tired, I give up. And at that moment, you should not forget all the hard work that got you where you are. After a while, the disappointment will be even greater than at the time you decide to leave. That is why you never have to give up, even though the difficulty is much greater than what you have thought possible. Fede, my coach, always mention a phrase that I repeat all days in my mind. There is pain that does not hurt. And I think that is part of the essence and passion of this sport that leaves you so much to live day to day. The pain always persists. You just have to know how to hide it. Thanks.
As everyone knows, it's been 228 days since quarantine started. And as every other normal human being, I decided to binge-watch some TV shows. Specifically, RuPaul's Drag Race, a reality show where drag queens compete to win a crown and money. For those of you who don't know what a drag queen is, please do yourself a favor and watch this TV show. So, as I was watching it, I noticed one of my favorite queens was wearing a very beautiful revealing dress. Now, keep in mind that these queens are men dressed as women. So, as she was dancing, I noticed that her nipple had shown. This did not bother me. What bothered me was that they had blurred her nipple, but when she took off her wig, her makeup, and her dress, they didn't. I would show you a picture, but Netflix won't let me take a screenshot, but you get the idea. When a person presents as a man, their nipples aren't covered, but when they present as a woman, they are. And that popped a question up in my head. Is it really the thing that bothers people, or is it the person involved in them? Does it really bother you when you see someone wearing a skirt, or does it bother you when you see a man wearing one? Does it bother you when you see someone showing their nipples in public, or does it bother you when a woman does? I have carried out a survey, and when I asked about the nipple thing, most of the people answered that they believe that women's nipples were censored because of the sexualization that was made by misogynistic men throughout history. And it's true. But it still does not justify this unfair behavior. But come on, the skirt thing, the makeup? Why can't we praise men for doing feminine things when we praise women for wearing suits? Think about it. Has a nipple ever grabbed an AK-47 and started shooting at you? Has a nipple ever called you a dum-dum? Has it? Have you ever had a traumatic experience with a skirt where it kidnapped you and choked you to death? No, but really, if you think about it, these things have never hurt anyone and never will. A trans person has never hurt you just for being trans. A topless woman has never hurt you just for being topless. And a man wearing a skirt has never hurt you just for being a man wearing a skirt. So, next time you find yourself in a situation like this, why don't you just try and mind your own business? The reverse method is the best for minding your own business. For example, let's say you are walking down the park and you see a woman breastfeeding. And you see her nipple, because her nipples are showing, obviously. And you feel even the slightest bothered by it. Now, imagine if a man was in her place. Would it bother you seeing a man's nipple in public? If not, mind your own business. Well, then you're walking down the street and you see a man wearing a skirt and makeup. Now, imagine if a woman was in his place. Would it bother you seeing a woman wearing a skirt and makeup? If not, mind your own business. Another good example is you see a woman and she's wearing a dress. But that woman is fat, and you think that that dress looks hideous on her, that it does not look good. Now imagine another woman is wearing that same dress, but she's skinny this time, she's thin. Now, unless you still believe that dress is hideous, then you did not have a problem with the dress, rather than with the person wearing it. You can now imagine millions of scenarios where the reverse method could be applied and where you can see if you really have a problem with the person or with the thing. Let this also be a lesson for life. Whenever you encounter yourself in a similar situation, apply the reverse method and check to see if your reaction and if it bothers you, if it's still justified. As this TED Talk is finishing, I invite you to mind your own business as I've been doing for the past month. It's really simple and it's really cleansing. It's like skincare for your mind. Thank you.
Two years ago, when I started to grow very fast, I went through a situation of bad nutrition. I wasn't eating well, so I was very close to becoming anemic. Anemia is a blood problem that suffers the people who don't eat as they should, and this generates certain changes in the body and different symptoms, such as fast heart rate, fatigue, breathing problems, among others. I needed iron supplements and vitamins. I was about to abandon the sport that I was playing because I didn't have enough strength to train. I had to go to a doctor, I had to do blood tests several times, I had a bad time, but luckily now I'm fine, and I can do everything I like. It is very important to have healthy feeding habits because the nutrients present in food provide the necessary energy to make daily activities and keep our body active. To be healthy and energetic every day, we have to follow a healthy and balanced diet. These diets are made by combining food effectively to ingest the necessary nutrients according to age, sex, and level of physical activity. Eating a lot or eating junk food very often is not having a good diet. It also has consequences, such as a weak body or digestive problems. Like I said before, having healthy feeding habits make us feel good to grow and have the necessary strength to carry out daily activities. On the contrary, having bad eating habits make children's growth stop, and as a consequence, they cannot carry out their daily tasks. What is worse, bad eating habits make children's growth stop and produce illnesses such as obesity, cardiovascular disorders, cancer, osteoporosis, hypertension, diabetes that might develop if a bad diet is maintained over the years. A big part of our well-being is based on good nutrition, so it's essential to eat healthy to be able to do everything we want to do, feel good, and not to have illnesses. On the other hand, I have been talking to Lourdes López Rendón. She's a nutritionist. She told me that it's very important to respect the four meals to have enough nutrients and be healthy. The four meals are lunch, breakfast, snack, and dinner. And Another thing is that each patient is given their own diet according to their sex, age, physical activity, weight, height, among other personal characteristics. A very interesting thing she told me is that most of the patients that go to her office only ask her how they can lose weight. But losing weight is not the only advantage of leading a healthy diet. It's much more than that. Have you ever suffered from an eating disorder? If you say yes, please raise your hand. Let me tell you a piece of advice. If you are going through a similar situation, talking to a relative, a professional, a friend, or a doctor will help you a lot. They can help you to be better and give you advice in bad and good moments. To conclude, I hope you have enjoyed this talk, and remember that having a healthy diet is very important to achieve everything we want to do. Thanks for your attention.
To be or not to be, that is the question. Surely it has happened to you that you were present in a place but absent of thought. Sometimes our mind takes us to places where we really want to be. Our thoughts drift towards other matters, but in a focused way. What an oxymoron, isn't it? But it's like people who realize that we are not focused tell us that we are in another world. And yes, in reality, we are in New York or in Paris, for example, or in Cortázar's hopscotch or in Borges' Aleph, that mythical point of the universe where all acts and all times coexist. We are where we choose to be, although around us, the rest, hopefully most of them, is witnessing a masterclass. The reality is the system. Once I was in the first or second year of secondary school, during a school act, we were there to honor San Martin. The last thing I heard was August, father of the Argentine people, the great hero of freedom. Padre Augusto del pueblo argentino, ere magno de la libertad. My thoughts stopped there. In Augusto's hero and great. And they began to drift towards many questions, such as, would San Martin be like that? And if that is an invention, hasn't he ever been wrong? One question led to another, and if he had been there, you could have certainly seen that I was in another world. It must have been very noticeable, because I came back to reality when I heard the voice of my headmaster. What are you laughing at, he said. Of course, I couldn't tell him I was somewhere else. In a spare of a moment, I was speechless, walking straight to the headmaster's office. The verdict? To listen to the March of San Martin until I learned that he was Augusto's hero and great. Fifth repetition, I kept asking myself the same question over and over. The solution? 3 reprimands or amonestaciones. And finally, I gained the freedom to go and inquire in order to fulfill my hypothesis. Believe or not believe, that was another matter. School for ladies, nun, mass, the rosary. And there it was again, a supreme almighty being, so much so that he had given us life and lost it for us. During primary school, Catholic education referred to some works of reflection that I did not dislike at all, and we even had to draw, which was one of my passions. But in high school, it changed. You had to study the Bible and recite prayers without straying from the word. And that's when I began to stray from the word. I wanted a real, tangible story. I couldn't think Jesus revived from the dead. Is that even possible? No way, there should be another answer to the story. The headmaster's office again. Sacrilege, he said. The solution? the visit of a priest to convince me to believe what I had to believe. His answer, faith. Obviously, I had not been born with that gift. And when the brake bell rang, I was finally able to investigate what had not been answered. The school was not for me, at least not that system. Little by little, I learned that it was better to keep silent about some thoughts. And I decided simply that if I didn't want to be in class, I wouldn't go. Yes, you will say the system, the absences. Yes, I had to take care of the absences because I was late many times. I lived a block and a half away from school, but the truth, I didn't want to get there. So I had to find motivation to make a plan. Before the first break, I got a tick on the roll. So after the first break, if I didn't like the subject, I could hide in the chapel choir. It was a corner that could be accessed through a small door, which no one kept an eye on. So there I read what I wanted to read. Cortázar, Borges, Nietzsche, who told me what I wanted to hear, autonomy, creativity, courage. But one day, I was found. So the solution, to reprimands. Dos amonestaciones más. Okay, so I learned to abstract myself in such a way that I didn't listen to anyone around me. The class was happening in front of me, but I was somewhere else. At this point, you may wonder if the system could with me. Yes, the system beat me. I finished my secondary school with 9-20 average, and today I'm an English teacher. After having been a writer, a literary critic, a cartoonist, American a filmmaker, a creative video editor, a tourism agent, a pastry chef, a mom of three. Everything I had to repress in my high school years was released when I finished it. My creativity and my need to inquire never left me, but I would have loved not to have suppressed them then. What if instead of an image of repression, I could have had a guide? How different would school have been for me? It was as easy as taking me to a school library or explain some issues respecting my beliefs. As easy as to allow me to reach an agreement, right? There are a lot of kids who are in a school, but they are actually not there. How can we do things differently? What if we give them the chance to inquire, to ask themselves and let them find the answers? Possibly today, we would not have so many deserters or so many boys and girls who reach the end without knowing what they want to be. Inquiry, creativity, autonomy, revealing oneself to the truth, to learn to think, knowing that they have the right to seek and find another explanation. It is difficult to change. But what if we start by respecting individualities so that school is enjoyable? One which nobody wants to be late or not to arrive at all, or to be and not to be. Guide and let be. That is the answer.
It's my turn! No! It's my turn! Oh, I'm tired of this! I hate you! No! I hate you!
Bueno, esto fue rememorando buenas épocas cuando podíamos ir al teatro y mostrar nuestros ensayos, nuestras presentaciones de drama. Los invitamos el lunes que viene a que asistan a la presentación de Kinky Revolution, que es una versión corta de Kinky Boots. Es lo que estuvimos trabajando en drama este último año, todo virtual. Pero bueno, es lo que pudimos hacer y quedó.
Y los van a ver a todos vestidos pipí cucú con unos trajes que no tienen nadie porque son de único modelo.
No, y además la producción estuvo, no es que acá más o menos.
y están más que invitados a ustedes mismos vestirse de al estilo Kinky Revolution con unas buenas botas rojas, muchos brillos y ser quien ustedes quieren ser, porque la canción dice Be who you wanna be, ¿no? Algo así. Cuestión, también tenemos más cosas para contarles acerca de lo que van a encontrar hoy en la expo. A continuación tenemos, esto fue lo que van a ver de charlas TED durante el día de hoy. El lunes que viene hay más charlas TED. Esto no es todo el proyecto.
No, son diferentes y son otros chicos.
Así que, por favor, si les gustaron todas las ideas que se presentaron hoy, que fueron muy variadas, muy interesantes, van a encontrar un montón de proyectos más el lunes que viene en las siguientes charlas. Por otro lado, ahora van a tener a los experimentos en casa de los chicos de tercer año. Y como dijimos antes, no todos tenemos un excelente desempeño en los laboratorios, siempre puede fallar. Si estamos hablando específicamente de mi persona, pueden preguntar en colegios anteriores, casi prendemos fuego a un laboratorio, pero bueno, bueno, son eventos del pasado, claro. Podía fallar. Por otro lado, también nosotros, bueno, ¿qué somos?
Ay,
nosotros?
Bueno,
nosotros,
¿qué
nosotros somos la promo 2020. La promo que, como muchos conocen, no se picó, la promo que...
Pero bueno, se pica en la virtualidad.
Pero se pica en la virtualidad. Sí. Entonces, si recorren los stands, van a encontrar nuestro yearbook, que está lleno de mensajitos, fotitos y mucho esfuerzo para hacer llorar a toda persona que lo lea. Después van a encontrar nuestras charlas TED, si las quieren volver a ver.
Sí, nuestras charlas en los 150 años de María Montessori.
Que también está específicamente hecha para hacer llorar a alguno que otro que se ponga muy emotivo acerca de... No queremos dar crédito, pero recibimos bastantes lágrimas por nuestro excelente desempeño. También van a encontrar el stand de música, que de paso está relacionada también con Kinky, ya que estamos hablando. Van a encontrar Funky de Charlie García, van a encontrar Everybody Say Yeah de Kinky Boots. Y bueno, eso, los chicos trabajaron un montón, así que por favor vayan a ver eso. Y bueno, ¿qué más les podemos ofrecer? La muestra está llena de proyectos de todos los cursos.
Todo lo que se trabajó en el año.
Así que los invitamos a que recorran, a que se tomen la libertad de revisar todos los stands.
A que no se caigan.
No se caigan del mapa porque no se puede volver a subir. Y lo decimos de la experiencia personal.
Pasaron cosas.
Y también van a encontrar los Zooms con los chicos que están esperándolos a ustedes para mostrarles, explicarles qué fue lo que se hizo durante el año. Son proyectos re interesantes, son todos re variados, así que por favor, tómense un minutito y vean todas las propuestas que están en nuestra muestra. Así que bueno, los dejamos ahora con tercer año, sus experimentos en casa, que la pasen bien, que se rían un rato.
Que la exploten.
Y que aprendan. Así que bueno, nos vemos dentro de un rato.
Nos vemos.
O del experimento que vamos a hacer Emilia y yo.
No, saludás en tercero y después decís que la experiencia que vas a mostrar es...
Ok.
¿Está? Bueno, ¿arrancamos? ¿Les parece?
Dale, dale.
¿Sí? Bueno. ¿Lu?
Bueno. Hola, buenas tardes. Nosotros somos tercer año... Y los que estamos acá nos anotamos para cada uno hacer, o en grupos, hacer un experimento que hicimos en el año. Son todos de diferentes temas, algunos se asimilan, pero algunos no. Y bueno, eso. Bueno, este experimento es un experimento de una reacción de descomposición que... hicimos Emilia De Marco y yo. Bueno, el experimento que hicimos es de una reacción muy sencilla y lo único que vamos a necesitar es agua oxigenada, un bol y una papa. Bueno, lo que vamos a hacer es en un bol verter agua oxigenada, la cantidad más o menos que equivalga a un poco de la papa, como que la cubra, y luego vamos a verter la papa en el bol con el agua oxigenada, y van a ver que a medida del tiempo se van a empezar a hacer unas burbujas. La imagen que está abajo es una imagen después de 5 segundos, cuando la papa está en el agua oxigenada. Bueno, y esta es una imagen después de 15 segundos. Bueno, esas burbujas que ustedes ven son indicio de oxígeno. ¿Pero por qué pasa esto? Bueno, el agua oxigenada está compuesta por 2 átomos de oxígeno y 2 átomos de hidrógeno. La baba tiene una enzima que se llama catalasa, la cual se encarga de separar una molécula de oxígeno del peróxido de hidrógeno. Entonces, cuando nuestra papa con su catalasa separa una molécula de oxígeno, nos quedarían 2 moléculas de hidrógeno y una de oxígeno, y eso es H2O.
Bien, Emilia, ¿vas a mostrar la experiencia?
Sí, otra cosa que podemos observar es que si introducimos fuego, utilizando un fósforo, reconocemos la presencia de oxígeno, ya que se aviva la llama. Esto es una reacción de combustión.
¿Podrías mostrar de nuevo lo del fuego?
Julieta.
Nos están escuchando todos. Estamos en vivo, Agus.
Ok.
Bien, seguimos entonces. A ver, Emilia. Ahí se te apagó.
Sí, no, se apaga por... Justamente por el agua.
Bien. Bien, gracias. A ver ahí. Ahí se ve perfecto. Muchas gracias. Bien. Agustín y Josefina.
Hola, buenos días. Con Josefina le vamos a hablar sobre una reacción química que sucede entre el huevo y el vinagre. Bueno, nosotros para realizar este experimento colocamos en un vaso vinagre y un huevo. Bueno, lo que podemos ver en la imagen son burbujas de dióxido de carbono, también conocido como CO2, el huevo, que está compuesto en un 90% de carbonato cálcico, la cáscara, y luego el vinagre, que también se puede llamar ácido acético. Bueno, lo que va a suceder en esta experiencia es una reacción química. Una reacción química es una transformación de la materia. Bueno, acá vemos que el segundo día se empieza a formar una espuma arriba del huevo. Vemos que aumenta la cantidad de dióxido de carbono, de burbujas, y la cáscara se empieza a desintegrar. Bueno, ya pasando al tercer día, el dióxido de carbono empieza a disminuir. Esto sucede porque lo que forma las burbujitas es la reacción entre el vinagre y la cáscara. Y como la cáscara se empieza a desintegrar, ya desaparece, cosa que no puede formar más burbujas. Bueno, cuando la cáscara se desintegra, queda una membrana semipermeable, la cual deja que ingrese agua. Y por ello hay un aumento de tamaño en el huevo. Bueno, acá podemos ver el huevo normal y el huevo en vinagre, que estuvo por 3 días en vinagre, que considerablemente es mucho más grande.
Bien, Josefina.
Bueno, yo voy a mostrar más o menos como el experimento, pero más por la parte física, no por la parte teórica. Bueno. Ahora tenemos el huevo, que estuvo 3 días en vinagre, y para comparar un poco, voy a mostrarlo, sin que se rompa, obvio. Y la textura es, como se ve, es un poquito más no es tan sólida como un huevo normal, es porque estuvo 3 días en vinagre. Esta reacción que se produce se conoce como reacción de desplazamiento. Por la cuestión física, la cáscara es mucho más suave y desapareció. Y por supuesto que aumentó su tamaño y también se siente más gomoso. Es como una pelotita, parece. Bueno, ahora viene la parte donde tendría que explotarlo, que lo voy a explotar acá para que no se rompa y no esté rígido. Ahora que se explotó, vamos a ver que la cáscara de acá quedó separada de la yema y la clara es mucho más consistente, por más que no se vea bien, y el olor es tiene un olor mezclado con vinagre. Por más que no pueda mostrarlo, el olor es bastante fuerte y se siente el olor a vinagre.
Muy bien, José. Seguimos con Vicente, Máximo.
Lo nuestro con Vicente Yáñez es el indicador de pH. Yo voy a empezar hablando sobre qué es el pH y después Bicho o Vicente va a hablar bien. El pH es el grado de acidez o alcalinidad de una solución. El pH se mide en una tabla de 14 factores, en el que 1 es extremadamente ácido y 14 extremadamente alcalino. Bueno, yo acá, ahora va Bicho, que va a explicar bien y después voy a mostrar yo.
Bueno, un indicador de pH es una sustancia que presenta un cambio visual cuando está a distintos niveles de pH. En este caso, el indicador de pH es este extracto de repollo, que es repollo procesado con alcohol etílico. Bueno, entonces lo que vamos a hacer va a ser mezclar el extracto de repollo con las diferentes soluciones, que son, en este caso, jugo de limón, lavandina y agua con bicarbonato de sodio. Entonces, ahí estoy agregándole extracto de repollo al jugo de limón. Y vemos cómo se tornó de un color distinto a lo que era. Después, con la lavandina, bueno, con la lavandina vemos que no cambia absolutamente nada. Y con el bicarbonato de sodio lo torna de un color más celeste. Ahora Máximo va a hacer con los suyos.
Y bueno, yo acá tengo el extracto de pollo, acá tengo cloruro de sodio o sal, como le quieran decir. Después acá tenemos agua, que es ya procesada, el agua común que tomamos, y agua de canilla. Bueno, voy a proceder a pasarlo. Para que repose. Acá vemos cómo se torna un tono azulado, no sé si se va a apreciar en la cámara.
¿Tenés una hoja blanca para poner detrás para que se vea el viraje de color?
Dame un segundito y lo pongo. Saco la hoja de abajo. A ver si ahí se puede apreciar.
Ahí se ve mejor, sí, sí.
Ahí está. Y ahora lo paso acá. Y ahí nos quedó. Esto después lo podemos pasar cortando tiritas de hojas. Cortamos tiritas de hojas, los ponemos adentro, los sacamos y dejamos que se seque. Y después de un rato nos queda el color y gracias a la tabla podemos diferenciar de qué está. Si es alcalino o ácido. Y nada, bien, sería eso.
Bien, y comparamos con la tabla. ¿Se acuerdan que habíamos visto la tabla de
la escala de pH con el extracto de alcohol grado?
Bien, que con estos colores, según las sustancias que ustedes notaron ahí, podíamos ver qué tipo de pH tenía cada una de las sustancias que utilizamos, ¿verdad?
Sí.
Bien, muy bien. Bueno, les agradecemos, ¿sí?, por vernos. Y los invitamos a ver el resto de nuestros proyectos en nuestro Instagram, ¿sí? Y a dejarnos algún mensaje por nuestro Padlet. Muchas gracias. A todos.
Nos vemos.
Bueno, con mucho orgullo podemos comentar, no reventó nada excepto el huevo que vimos que pincharon, pero bueno, creo que estaba en los planes.
Creo que estaba en los planes. Todo calculado, todo perfecto. Bien.
Bueno, mientras estamos esperando que los chicos de cuarto vengan a su presentación de energías renovables con la misma profe Julieta Lampert, les vamos a comentar un poco más sobre los proyectos que pueden encontrar en la expo. Bien. Así que les vamos a hablar de algo en lo que somos especialistas, que es el proyecto Uniendo Metas.
Y siempre lo tenemos que mencionar, es como que siempre aparece por ahí.
Un poquitito tenemos que...
Que, bueno, demostrar
todo nuestro trabajo y todos nuestros logros a lo largo de esta larga carrera de la ONU, que este año era el último año nuestro.
Sí, pero nos mintieron.
Pero no importa, porque igual les estamos dejando con un montón de chicos copados un legado genial de la ONU para que todos los demás puedan ir a participar. Así que en alguno de los stands, que ahora no me puedo acordar el nombre,
debe ser grande.
Si siguen nuestro consejo y están recorriendo la feria, lo van a encontrar. Está el stand de la ONU en la que van a encontrar un poco del proyecto, que a grandes rasgos es básicamente debatir, representar un país y buscar un consenso para alguna problemática mundial que se elige dependiendo el modelo o la ciudad. No solo es genial porque es súper divertido y bueno, está bien, tiene un trasfondo, un par de horas de estudio, un poco de...
Pero vale la pena.
Un poco de trasnochada.
Vale la pena, uno aprende después como que, los debates para la escuela después le vienen bien porque uno es el capo ahí.
Uno chamulla.
Bueno.
Pero igual todos estamos de acuerdo que lo que más nos copa son los alfajores igual mayen que no dan en los recreos.
Pero bueno. Tiene que haber un trabajo y después un premio, entonces siempre...
Exactamente. Así que bueno, no solo eso, sino que también si les preguntan a los chicos que participaron en los distintos modelos, nos los pasamos viajando a diferentes ciudades, nos hacemos un montón de amigos y la experiencia es excelente.
El viaje a Mar del Plata.
Eso es todo lo que vale.
Y uno tiene que trabajar, pero después, bueno.
El viaje a Mar del Plata es el que va. Y después tenemos otras cuestiones. Perdón, cerrando. Un poco más de toda esta muestra lo van a encontrar en nuestro stand. Pero también tenemos, hablando de stands, que comentarles que van a encontrar un par de trabajos de portugués, porque acá en este colegio no solo hacemos trabajos de inglés, sino que también van a encontrar trabajos de portugués. Y quizás con algo de suerte hay algo colado de francés en la charla de 150 años de Montessori. Así que por favor, los invitamos a que recorran estos stands, porque en portugués se hicieron unas presentaciones muy lindas acerca de la situación actual en Brasil, para que conozcan un poco el país, para que conozcan un poco nuestro trabajo. Y bueno, para dar a reconocer un poco que tenemos esta materia y que claramente todos lo hablamos perfectamente fluido.
Nosotros somos trilingües acá, señores, ¿sí? No.
Cuatrilingües,
claro, no.
Esa es la copropiedad.
Y que ya no los podemos contar, sí.
Por otro lado, ya cerrando un poco, van a encontrar otro stand en el que debería estar yo, pero bueno, acá estamos Piripona animando la fiesta y uno no puede estar en todos lados.
Pero, más o menos.
Pero estoy ahí casi porque hay un precio completamente autoexplicativo en el que van a encontrar videos, actividades y un poco del taller Adolescencia, Conocerme y Conocernos, que aprovecho este espacio publicitario para poder hacer un poco de marketing al taller. Es un taller sobre aceptación, sobre crecimiento y sobre el trabajo en equipo en primer año. Todos sabemos que pasar de sexto grado a primer año puede ser una experiencia un poco
traumante.
Traumante. Pero en este taller nosotros nos dedicamos en fomentar el trabajo en equipo, la unión, el compañerismo y diferentes conceptos como la aceptación, la diversidad y las diferencias. Así que si están interesados en ver en lo que estuvieron trabajando los chicos de primer año este año, que se recoparon y se sumaron a la virtualidad, los invitamos a que pasen por el stand, que van a encontrar un videito hermoso de una especie de video musical que estuvimos armando este año, un par de actividades, un par de fotos, un par de anécdotas y algo del grupo del año pasado. Así que bueno, creo que ya utilicé un montón de este espacio publicitario.
Y bueno, siempre.
Y ahora van a encontrar a los chicos de cuarto año con energías renovables. ¿Estamos listos? Entonces, cuarto año, ahí va.
¿Ya?
No.
Ah, ok.
Estoy esperando que entren todos y. Y a ver, esperen que cierro esto.
Uy, tengo muchas cosas acá. Cerrar.
Ah. Bueno, ya estamos en el aire, así que. Igna, ¿presentás?
Bien. Buenas tardes. Nosotros somos los chicos de cuarto y, bueno, a continuación les vamos a estar presentando lo que estuvimos trabajando sobre las energías renovables, parte de lo que nos va a acompañar en el conocimiento a crear un nuevo al proyecto final, el cual es crear un cohete de agua, y gracias a las energías renovables podemos aprender muchas cosas, las cuales, bueno, ahora con los compañeros vamos a estar presentando. Entre ellas están la energía eólica, también hay otras que no las estamos presentando, pero vamos a estar hablando un poco de qué son y de qué se tratan estas energías.
Bien, nosotras con Isabela Farali investigamos sobre la energía mareomotriz. Bien. ¿En qué consiste la energía mareomotriz? Bien, la energía mareomotriz se consigue aprovechando las mareas. Esta energía se produce por los movimientos de las turbinas hidráulicas que se encuentran abajo del agua. Se activan gracias a las mismas mareas. Estas turbinas generan energía eléctrica que se dirige a una base de tierra y de ahí se distribuye a la comunidad.
Bueno. Lisa, ¿estás ahí? Ahí está.
La primera planta de energía mareomotriz se realizó en Bretaña Francesa entre 1960 y 1966, hace aproximadamente 60 años. Luego la segunda se realizó en un mar de Rusia, muy cerca de Finlandia, en 1968. La tercera fue casi 12 años después, en China, y por último en Canadá. Esas son las cuatro principales que hay alrededor.
Bien, la energía mareomotriz tiene ventajas y desventajas. Bien, las ventajas. Es una energía inagotable, ya que el agua no se agota. No utiliza combustibles, por lo tanto no produce químicos ni tóxicos, y no genera efecto invernadero y no contamina el planeta. Una vez el sistema instalado, no es muy caro mantenerlo. Las desventajas. La aplicación de estas turbinas sí es muy costoso, por eso cuesta mucho que estén en todos los países y que esta energía avance. Tiene un impacto medio negativo sobre la fauna y la flora, es un obstáculo para las rutas de los animales y alteran a los ecosistemas. Esto también tiene una desventaja, ya que la energía marea motriz se tiene que colocar en lugares muy específicos, porque no todas las mareas funcionan bien para que esas turbinas funcionen correctamente. Bien, la energía marea motriz en Argentina. Argentina actualmente se encuentra en el tercer país más apto para generar la energía marea motriz, teniendo en cuenta que se puede usar en toda la costa patagónica. Bien, el Golfo de San José, ubicado en Chubut, es uno de los proyectos más prometedores relacionados a esta energía. El potencial eléctrico de este país vía esta energía marea motriz es muy alta, ya que es de 40.000 megavoltios. Teniendo en cuenta este número y el costo económico para implementar los artefactos y las maquinarias, no solo se podría abastecer a toda la Patagonia, sino también exportar esta misma energía. Estás muteada, Isa.
Esta energía alrededor del mundo debería ser incrementada, ya que hay muy pocos puntos principales. Podemos ver que en América hay tan solo 3, una en México, una en Canadá y la que dijo mi compañera en Argentina. En África directamente no hay puntos de energía meremotriz, en Oceanía hay uno solo, hay 3 en Europa, 2 en Gran Bretaña y 1 en Francia, y tan solo 1 en India. Esta energía se encuentra en el ranking de las 10 más utilizadas, en el puesto 8 bajo la ondimotriz. La ondimotriz, a diferencia de la maremotriz, utiliza las olas, mientras que la energía maremotriz utiliza las mareas. El Pacto Verde de la Unión Europea es un pacto que tiene como principal objetivo eliminar la contaminación y disminuir la cantidad de emisiones de gases con efecto invernadero al medio ambiente. Para eso, el 70% de las emisiones que hace la Unión Europea es por el gran uso de electricidad, y tan solo el 17,5% de esa electricidad es por las energías renovables. Entonces, uno de los proyectos que tienen en este pacto es aumentar los puntos de energías renovables en toda Europa, entre ellas la energía maremotriz.
Bien, nosotros hicimos un prototipo de esta energía para producir electricidad y que se prenda una lucecita LED. Bien, el video. Bien, lo que hicimos nosotros fue agarrar una pecera y dividirla en dos con una madera. Luego, para un lado de la pecera, hicimos un cuadrado de madera y lo pegamos con un telgopor para que quede en la superficie. A esa misma madera le colocamos un cordón, que ese cordón en la punta tiene un imán. Bien, por otro lado hicimos una bobina con un tubo de papel, enrollado con cable de cobre y en las puntas la lucecita LED. Espero que siga el video. Bien. Esa madera que ven que está sola es la que hicimos para que genere presión de arriba hacia abajo, que eso generan las mareas, y así el imán con el cable de cobre genera fricción y eso genera electricidad y hace que se prenda la lucecita LED. Ahí Julio va a mostrar un video que se ve. Muchas gracias.
Perdón, se me fue, pero ahí se puede apreciar la lamparita cómo se prende. Muy bien.
No funcionó. Muchas gracias.
Bien, bueno, junto a Mateo, Tomás y Matilde estuvimos trabajando acerca de la energía eólica y qué es un poco esta, ¿no? Vamos a estar contando al respecto. Es energía renovable, como todo, como la anterior que estuvimos trabajando, y nada, bueno, arrancamos. Bien, la energía eólica tiene sus principales usos, o ni bien se empezó a utilizar cuando fue la era de los vikingos, en donde ellos lo utilizaban para propulsarse gracias al viento con sus velas y poder navegar por los mares nórdicos, y esto lo que hacía era básicamente utilizar el viento inconscientemente o conscientemente, pero lo que hacían no era generar ningún tipo de electricidad. Luego, alrededor del 1800, se empezó a implementar en los molinos a viento, que hoy quedan pocos, quedan muchos en todo lo que es la zona de Holanda, y esa zona siempre se ven molinos de viento, pero recién hace 40 años es que se empezó a utilizar como energía para poder abastecer electricidad a viviendas, a parques, a plazas, a diferentes lugares en donde la energía no llegaba, y gracias a la energía eólica se pudo alcanzar.
Bueno, el funcionamiento de los aerogeneradores es el siguiente. El viento hace que se muevan las aspas, que a su vez están conectadas a través de un buje. Para que las aspas puedan girar a velocidades más altas, ya que el viento hace que se muevan a velocidades muy leves y que esto no pueda generar la suficiente cantidad de energía eléctrica, se necesita lo que se llama caja de cambios o multiplicador, que lo que permite que a través de un sistema de engranajes, lo que hace es que acelera la velocidad de las aspas y permite ganar más energía. Para que se den una idea más o menos cómo es como si fuera el sistema de las bicicletas, ya que uno pedalea a una determinada velocidad y la bicicleta se mueve más rápido. Luego de esto tenemos lo que se llama generador, que lo que hace es justamente generar de ese movimiento energía eléctrica. Pero acá hay un problema, porque el generador, la energía eléctrica que genera, la genera con baja tensión. Entonces, para poder transportarla se necesitan alta tensión, pero para eso está el transformador, que lo que hace es transformar esa energía eléctrica de baja tensión a alta tensión para poder transportarla. Luego de esto, la energía eléctrica se transforma a través de cables hasta una central eléctrica, y de ahí se distribuye a todas las casas, negocios, etc.
Bien, las ventajas de la energía eólica es que es un tipo de energía renovable que no contamina, es un recurso inagotable, reduce el uso de los combustibles fósiles, ayuda al desarrollo sostenible, ocupa poco espacio, es de bajo costo, y nos hace mucho menos dependientes de importaciones de energía, y eso genera mucho dinero.
Bien, aunque estas son las ventajas, las desventajas, aunque sean menores la cantidad de estas, siempre hay, por ejemplo, una de las grandes desventajas y problemáticas, y es más, hay una ley que lo impide, que no se pueden instalar parques eólicos en lo que son zonas de migraciones, porque afectan los cursos de las aves, y luego, bueno, pueden terminar con migraciones desviadas o cambios en el ecosistema que podrían afectar al mismo. Después, no siempre, hay que saber que no siempre hay una buena corriente de aire, entonces no se puede utilizar en todos los lugares del mundo como lo puede ser la energía solar, que siempre hay lo que es esta, básicamente. Bueno, parques en Argentina y en el mundo. En lo que es a nivel internacional, las principales potencias mundiales que tienen mayor cantidad de parques eólicos se encuentran, por ejemplo, Estados Unidos, China, Alemania, India, España y Brasil. Después, a favor o en contra, Argentina está en el puesto 35 de este ranking con mayor cantidad de parques eólicos, y su utilización, bueno, ahora lo va a explicar bien Mateo, pero está más que nada en lo que es la cordillera argentina y que limita con Chile.
Bueno, como la mayoría debemos saber, o por ahí nos debemos imaginar, la Argentina es un país que cuenta con una geografía muy amplia y muy variada, y esto hace que para este tipo de energía sea muy bueno. Pero lamentablemente tenemos muy pocos proyectos en el país, que son, tenemos 5 proyectos en la provincia de Buenos Aires, 4 en Santa Cruz, 1 en Neuquén, otro en San Juan, y por último 1 en La Pampa.
Bien, el Vortex. No muchos de ustedes lo deben conocer, el Vortex es una tecnología muy avanzada y de esta época, no tiene mucho más de 10 años lo que es la tecnología ya aplicada a nivel industrial. El Vortex es un pequeño aparato que luego vamos a estar mostrando un video, es un pequeño aparato que tiene forma de bate de béisbol, no produce sonido, es de bajo costo, y en comparación a los grandes aerogeneradores, este es muchísimo más chico, ahora lo vamos a ver bien. ¿Quién fue el que descubrió este sistema? Fue Theodore Carman. Theodore Carman lo que hizo fue describir el movimiento del viento en ondulaciones, ahí tenemos una imagen entre violetas, amarillos y celestes, en donde claramente se ve cómo es que el viento tiene su movimiento específico, él lo diseñó y se aplica en el Vortex. Ahora vamos a estar viendo un video.
Así funciona el molino sin aspas creado en España. Una tecnología española aspira a transformar radicalmente el paisaje de la energía eólica, con la fabricación de molinos sin aspas, más eficientes y baratos, que además no molestan ni matan a los pájaros. Esta tecnología se llama Vortex Bladeless, y tras 5 años de desarrollo ya está a punto de convertirse en realidad. La idea se le ocurrió al ingeniero David Yánez, cuando observaba un vídeo del derrumbamiento del puente de Tacoma Narrows, ocurrido en 1940. Debido a un acoplamiento estructural entre el viento y el propio puente, este comenzaba a oscilar como si fuese una hoja de papel movida por el viento, hasta que finalmente se derrumbó. Lo interesante de este desastre arquitectónico es que el viento, al cruzar el puente, generaba una energía tan grande como para derrumbarlo. ¿Y si esa energía se pudiese aprovechar para generar electricidad? Ese es el principio de los molinos sin palas de Vortex Bladeless. Las turbinas eólicas sin palas de Vortex Bladeless capturan energía por medio de la vorticidad, así que técnicamente no son turbinas. Estos molinos sin aspas atrapan la energía del viento cuando entra en resonancia debido a un efecto aerodinámico denominado desprendimiento de vórtices. Cuando la frecuencia de estas fuerzas está lo suficientemente cerca de la frecuencia estructural del cuerpo, el, valga la redundancia, cuerpo, comienza a oscilar y entra en resonancia con el viento, es decir, genera molinos. Este oscilamiento genera una fuerza que produce una electricidad. En palabras sencillas, el oscilamiento del molino en relación al viento genera fuerzas que se pueden convertir en electricidad. Es un sistema entre un 47 y un 50% más eficiente que una turbina eólica convencional, ya que funciona aunque el viento sople en cualquier dirección, mientras que los molinos con aspas requieren un determinado ángulo del viento. Al no tener aspas ni engranajes, estos molinos Vortex Bladeless son más baratos de fabricar, más silenciosos y son menos peligrosos para las aves. Tampoco necesitan aceite para engrasar las mencionadas palas, así que no generan residuos. Terminan con las dos principales críticas de las turbinas eólicas, los residuos de los lubricantes y la muerte de aves. A principios de 2019, el desarrollo de las turbinas eólicas sin palas ya está completado en un 95%. La certificación ya se encuentra al 50% y la manufacturación al 5%. Si todo va bien, las versiones finales de Vortex Bladeless podrían comenzar a probarse en entornos reales este mismo año.
Bien, ahí vimos un poco de qué se trataba lo que estaba explicando, y ahora, bueno, Tomás va a estar explicando qué fue lo que nosotros hicimos para representar lo que hace el viento con los aerogeneradores.
Bien, la experiencia principal consistía en conseguir un motorcito chiquito, como se ve ahí, de 12 voltios, y que con algunos palos, como se ve ahí en la imagen, en las imágenes, y algunas tapas, intentar hacer algo parecido a un molino eólico. Como se ve ahí, ese motor está conectado con dos cables que llevan a una lamparita LED. Eso se suponía, se supone que al soplar con alguna fuente de viento, hiciera funcionar al motor y eso hiciera funcionar a la lamparita. A nosotros nos pasó que no nos funcionó, entonces intentamos con un cooler de computadora, que conectando ese cooler con la lamparita LED mediante cables, soplando ese cooler funciona y se prende la lamparita.
Bien, acá bueno, vamos a demostrar qué es lo que sucede. Yo tengo acá el cooler, que es un aparato que está en la computadora. Lo que voy a hacer, primero me voy a mutear porque si no los voy a aturdir un poco. Así que, nada, voy a soplar en lo que es el cooler que tiene estas aspas, y con la fuerza del viento lo que se va a lograr es que se prenda la lamparita. Si este no se prende es porque el viento que yo generé no es el suficiente para que haga funcionar la lamparita, y esperemos que funcione.
Se vio que se prendió.
Costó un poco, pero bueno, se funciona y ahora estoy un poco mareado. Lo vamos a dejar por un lado. Bien, y nada, bueno, podemos concluir que esta experiencia nos sirvió para aprender en qué se basa la energía eólica. Qué utiliza, qué maneras se pueden utilizar para incorporar la energía a nuestro entorno, si es económica, qué beneficios, qué desventajas tiene. Y nada, muchas gracias por escucharnos.
Buenas tardes, nosotros vamos a presentar la energía hidráulica. Nosotros somos Candela Ardiles, Ignacio Zabalza, Tomás Coluso y Valentina Falcucci. Bueno, la energía hidráulica o hidroeléctrica es la obtención de electricidad. Esta es aquella que se obtiene del aprovechamiento de las energías cinéticas y potenciales a partir de la corriente del agua. Las centrales de esta energía generalmente se ubican donde existen una combinación adecuada de lluvias y desniveles geológicos favorables para la construcción de represas.
Bueno, los orígenes de esta energía son antiguos, porque se convirtió en una fuente de energía eléctrica a finales del siglo XIX. Fue Jim Francis quien desarrolló la primera turbina moderna para el agua, y fue en 1882 la primera planta de energía hidráulica del mundo empezó a operar en Estados Unidos, a lo largo del río Fox, en Appleton, Wisconsin.
Bueno, ¿cómo funciona la energía hidráulica? El aprovechamiento de los recursos naturales para poder producir energía limpia es muy importante en la lucha contra el cambio climático, como es el caso de la energía solar fotovoltaica y la energía eólica. La energía hidráulica es una energía renovable que aprovecha la fuerza del agua para poder generar así energía eléctrica. La energía hidráulica existe desde hace mucho tiempo. Es más, en entornos rurales antes era habitual aprovechar el paso de un río para así con una pequeña represa poder mover una rueda y a la vez así generar un movimiento aplicado y poder generar energía.
La energía hidráulica es realmente eficaz. A gran escala es una fuente muy rentable, pero siempre dependiendo de la productividad y del tamaño de producción de las presas. Las plantas de energía hidráulica moderna pueden aprovechar hasta el 90% de la energía. Con eso podemos saber que es realmente eficaz, pero a diferencia de las antiguas, solo pueden el 50%.
Bueno, ventajas y desventajas. Una ventaja de esta energía es que es una energía limpia que no produce emisiones tóxicas durante su funcionamiento. La gran ventaja de esta energía es la eliminación de combustible. Por otro lado, es una energía renovable. Como viene directamente de la lluvia, siempre se repone, por lo que el agotamiento de esta energía es prácticamente imposible. Y por último, esta energía es muy económica. Lo caro es construir la central hidroeléctrica, pero la fuente de energía se renueva de forma gratuita y no depende de variaciones del mercado. Y por otro lado, las desventajas es que tiene consecuencias medioambientales negativas. Hay que tener en cuenta que la construcción de centrales hidroeléctricas puede afectar gravemente a los animales y a las plantas, como la calidad del agua. Es verdad que a veces puede verse afectado por sequías. Es cierto que no siempre depende de la lluvia, pero las temporadas con muchas sequías puede ser un problema para la vía de generar energía por esta vía. Y es difícil encontrar el lugar ideal, es necesario que esté ubicado en el sitio adecuado y es dependiente del curso del agua para que se pueda sacar el mayor partido posible al terreno.
¿Qué tipos de energía hidráulica existen? Generalmente se habla de tres tipos de energía hidráulica, siempre dependiendo del sistema que se utilice al extraer el agua de los ríos para convertirlo en electricidad. La más conocida es la energía hidráulica a partir de embalses. Consiste en construir un embalse que controle y almacene el agua de un río para que luego el embalse deje pasar la corriente que sea necesaria a través de la turbina que está girando, conectada a un generador que es el que produce tal energía. Después está la energía mediante la inmersión de corriente, que consiste en desviar y manejar la corriente del río hacia otros cauces artificiales. De esta manera se usa ese agua para regar o volver al río y hacer que pase por las turbinas que están conectadas al generador para producir la corriente. Después está la que es mediante almacenamiento bombeado, que consiste en dos reservorios de agua situados a diferentes alturas. Al dejar caer el de la parte superior a la que está a la inferior, se genera la energía. Una parte de esta puede utilizarse para impulsar el agua hacia arriba para que siga habiendo capacidad de generación.
Bueno, nuestro país cuenta con un total de 31 represas hidroeléctricas y entre ellas se destacan las binacionales Yacyretá y Salto Grande. Por otro lado, las centrales de Piedra del Águila y El Chocón en la provincia de Neuquén. La usina Bamba, que fue inaugurada en 1897, fue la primera central hidroeléctrica de Argentina que fue destinada al servicio público. Bueno, y en este mapa podemos ver todas las centrales hidroeléctricas con las que cuenta Argentina. Bueno, esta tan conocida obra es un complejo hidroeléctrico que genera el 40% de la energía que consume Argentina. Es uno de los mayores atractivos turísticos en Corrientes y todos los que se acerquen a la provincia pueden ver esta obra. Fue construida sobre las aguas del Paraná y comenzó a generar energía en septiembre del 1994 con la puesta en marcha de su primera turbina. Bueno, se ubica en el río Paraná, a unos 20 kilómetros de la ciudad de Ituzaingó, en Corrientes.
Bueno, nosotros con este experimento queríamos mostrar que la fuerza del agua puede hacer girar una turbina y esa turbina generar energía. En las centrales hidroeléctricas se construyen tubos que van para abajo para que el agua vaya con mayor velocidad a girar el generador y de la central que mande energía. Que ahora lo va a explicar Tomás Curioso.
Bueno, esto lo realizamos, lo primero que hicimos fue buscar una tabla que sea lisa para después poner dos tablitas para arriba con un agujero en cada lado a la misma altura para poner un alambre de 30 centímetros que pase entre medio de los dos con un disco con 16 cucharas pegadas alrededor Después le pegamos otro disco por la parte, o sea, por el otro lado para terminar de cubrirla. Y le pusimos una tapita de gaseosa de cada lado para mantener al alambre más fijo y que gire todo. Después del lado afuera coloqué una polea y le puse un elástico, que ese elástico se engancha al motor y hace que al agua mover eso, hace que se prenda la luz.
Bueno, y así podemos concluir con el trabajo realizado. Los invitamos a ver el resto de nuestros proyectos en el Instagram de Cuarto Física Montessori 2020. Y también tenemos un Padlet en el cual pueden comentar acerca de qué es lo que se estuvo haciendo. Esto después lo vamos a estar mostrando en la presentación. Y nada, muchas gracias por estar y por ver lo que estuvimos trabajando en el año.
Bueno, hasta luego.
Muchas gracias.
Bueno, ya estamos de vuelta, ya casi...
Con el final.
Exactamente, ya casi terminando la muestra del día de hoy. Les recordamos que el lunes que viene siguen los proyectos, van a poder seguir recorriendo las muestras. Si saben de alguien que se la perdió hoy, lo pueden visitar el lunes que viene, porque además el lunes que viene es... alto día, ¿por qué?
Sí, ¿por qué? Y Kinky Revolution, no es Kinky Boots, es Kinky Revolution, tenemos un nombre propio.
Porque es una adaptación.
Es una adaptación única. Y es original y no es lo mismo, entonces...
Y además es algo...
No,
one night no, and one night only.
Claro, no, esto es exclusivo, por favor.
Exactamente, así que les recordamos que de hecho acá tienen a parte del cast. Les recordamos que van a estar los chicos de drama presentando Kinky Boots, todos disfrazados, todos maquillados, todos...
Bailando,
cantando, hay cantantes.
Hay cantantes, pero no soy yo, pero hay cantantes.
Pero hay cantantes, ¿no? Los van a ver cantar y hacer playback. Y también van a estar...
Bueno, puede pasar.
Los chicos de música presentando las canciones que estuvieron haciendo, que si no me equivoco, Raise You Up... y dos más.
Song of a Man y The Most Beautiful Thing.
Exactamente. In the world, y Everybody Say Yeah. Van a estar los chicos presentando los proyectos que hicieron, las grabaciones que hicieron. Y bueno, ahora, ya que finalizó la exposición de cuarto año de física, ¿qué es lo que nos acompaña? De nuevo, cuarto año con biología, con la muestra de.
Enzima catalasa. Es difícil el nombre, disculpen. Pero enzima catalasa de la mano de Candela Riles.
Exacto.
En biología.
Y después les recordamos, ya que estamos acá y que nos dijeron por la cucaracha, que está el stand de Olimpiadas Matemáticas, que los chicos estuvieron trabajando para esas Olimpiadas, también participaron, por lo que tengo entendido fue un trabajo bastante arduo el que hicieron, así que los invitamos a que vayan a revisar un poco ese stand. Y tenemos otros stands, también nos dijeron de literatura.
De literatura tenemos nosotros.
Nosotros estamos presentando en literatura.
Producciones un poco peculiares, así que no se asusten, estamos todos bien de la cabeza acá. A veces se nos chispotea alguna que otra cosa, pero es todo artístico.
Es todo artístico, a todos nos nace de lo más profundo del corazón. Así que vayan a ver los stands. Y ahora los invitamos a que vean la última presentación de la noche. Y de nuevo los esperamos el lunes que viene siendo Pin y Pon.
Pin.
Y pon. Muy bien. No, todavía no coordinamos el saludo.
Para el lunes que viene ya vamos a estar todo.
Exactamente. Así que bueno, los invitamos a que vean Biología de Cuarto Año y que tengan un buen lunes.
Buen lunes, buena semana.
Podríamos juntos ser todos. próxima.